E do la parola al professor Hubertus Kohle della Ludwig Maximilians Universität di Monaco, il quale ci parlerà di social tagging and innovative workflows in the internet.
Grazie. Questo ammirevole congresso, ammirevole in tutti i sensi, potrebbe dare l'impressione che i temi che noi discutiamo qui siano già entrati nel cuore delle nostre materie, il che almeno parlo della Germania, ma ho l'impressione che sia un po' simile anche in altri posti, non è per niente vero. La riserva mentale fra i miei colleghi è talmente grande che può fare paura, e io voglio incoraggiare i giovani ad andare avanti su questa strada. La materia della storia dell'arte sarà diversa da quella di oggi, ma una materia che non cambia è morta. Ora passo all'inglese. Tratterò un tema un po' strano, forse, e voglio anche fare degli appunti metodologici. With my paper, I want to draw your attention to a field of literary practice which has not often been seen in conjunction with the sciences, let alone with the humanities. The reason for this is to be found in the fact that social tagging is intimately connected with the internet, still a somewhat embattled medium, especially in the humanities, and even more importantly in the way data are collected. The two words in the concept of social tagging refer to the activity itself and exactly this way in collecting data just mentioned. To tag means to annotate a resource, be that a text, a sound, a picture, or whatever. Social is related to the source of these annotations, which is not the individual expert, but a more or less unknown member of the mass. To be sure, this tagging process is completely free. The taggers can write down whatever they want. They are not bound by ontologies which coerce them in a controlled conceptual system. What can the crowd contribute to sublime sciences and humanities? It is known in social bookmarking systems, in Facebook, Flickr, and a whole range of evaluation sites in the internet. The famous I like in Facebook will be of help when the problem arises if the restaurant on the other side of the street is worth to be visited or not. But for physics or art history, aren't they too complicated and mysterious to become controlled by the undefined crowd? Yes and no is my answer, and as you might expect, most of the time I have for this paper will be dedicated to the no. The one sphere where social tagging has had a certain success in academic work and has been taken seriously is the library. Libraries have certain problems with traditional ways of making accessible their sources, which means books. The annotations on the content of the book selected by experts are not identical with those that are taken by the readers when they look for publications. And they tend to be less and less so. This does not mean that the keywords chosen by the experts are bad ones, probably even the contrary is true, which means that those figured by the users are somewhat amateurish, but keywords are made for these users. You better change the words than the readers. Why not give readers themselves the possibility to add such keywords? I know of some few libraries that are experimenting with such procedures, and you will be able to imagine the huge resistances within these libraries by librarians afraid of losing their field of expertise or even their employment. But apart from the fact that most of even the innovators underline that expert and social tagging are not alternatives but mutually supporting procedures, there is one central problem connected with tagging books, and this is the time lag between looking at the tagging site, which is in this case the library catalog, and coming back to it when readers are able to annotate the book. You evidently have to read the book before you are able to add keywords to the catalog, and who will be willing to come back to the site after having read the book? Another object offers more chances for successful tagging, and here we are approaching our own field of interest, the one which is related to the history of the arts. Pictures have always been considered inferior to texts in a logocentric world. They are universally understandable, but at the same time they are flat. At least this is their reputation. Text needs time in order to be understood. pictures open up immediately, again considering what is generally thought. What is a drawback in this perspective might become an advantage for us who are interested in finding out about the potentials for social tagging. A picture is immediately ready for being annotated, and if it has a sky, there will be many of the taggers who write down sky, and they will be right to do so. This is the basic idea that we are realizing in a project which had very simple aims in the beginning and afterwards demonstrated to have far-reaching consequences. You are all familiar with digital image databases, and you know that some of them are really huge. I just mentioned Prometheus, which is a German metadatabase integrating almost 60 individual databases with about 800,000 reproductions of artworks produced by private enthusiasts, museums, and universitarian institutions. As it is a lot less time-consuming and even partly automatable to scan the images than to make them textually accessible, and for the time being, textual metadata reflect the common academic approach to works of art, every single dataset often includes only very basic descriptions of the work, and they especially lack iconographic and stylistic metadata. This means that the potential of such databases is rarely fully exploited. The traditional way would be to engage experts for annotating the images using, for example, IconClass for a professional iconographic valorization. It is obvious that this is a very laborious and expensive procedure, and considering the fastly growing image databases, it seems to be doomed to fail. So let's invite the crowds to do that. Okay, they are not checked about their qualifications, but on the other hand, they are many, and they might work for free if you allow for alternative satisfactions. The problem will be to fight the negative and to enhance the positive conditions. Of course, we first had to fight the quality reservation, which is sort of a killer argument against many of the new internet applications. There is one very basic critique which is grounded in the facts, and this is indeed a fact, that completely unknown internet players might tend to be trolls and intentionally make bullshit annotations. Indeed, the use of a tag Arnold Schwarzenegger under an image of St. Peter is dubious. In order to avoid these obstructions, we used the ingenious idea of American information scientist Louis van Aan, who organized the annotation process in the form of a game. Two persons connected to the internet were invited to play among each other, and only in case that both tagged the same word, this word was accepted, matched, and included in the database for future searches. The wisdom behind this simple but ingenious idea, we would even then not be able to avoid someone who tagged St. Peter with Arnold Schwarzenegger and another one with, say, Barack Obama, but we could be almost 100% sure that never ever two persons not known to each other would both tag Schwarzenegger or respectively Obama at the same time. In case you want to play the game already in the room, you have to enter artigo.org. This is indeed the basic idea, the rest is almost routine. Although technically quite demanding. The tagging game was called Artigo. We had a proof of concept running online for more than 2 years. Then we got a grant from the German Science Foundation in order to produce a more professional version and to increase the number of players. By now we have almost 7,000 registered players and 4,000 with no account, which is somewhat deluding because disappointing. I thought about 1 million players after 2 years, but we didn't attract them. We have collected as many as 750,000 matches after 3 years, and what might also be interesting, the number of matches amounts to only 23%. Of the text, which means that there is a lot of nonsense or many, many sophisticated words not yet matched and subject to a future matching process. As you can see in the top of the introductory screen, I don't even know if you can recognize that, but I think you do, we have an English, a French, and a German version of the game, but understandably most of the players are German-speaking. Below you can register in order to collect points which you get for successful, which means matched tags. We used to pay 50 euros for the monthly high scorer, but this has become too expensive, and actually people do not play for the money, but for a mixture of self-interest and cooperativeness. Self-interest, because they hope that what they carry out will also be done by others, so that soon a powerful search tool will be available. And cooperativeness, because obviously this seems to be a big topic in economics. The human being is less self-referred than normally conceptualized in our liberal capitalist worldview. On the right, the poor translator, I'm sorry, I have to speak quickly. On the right, you see the search box. Below, in the left middle, you get some information on Artigo, although we generally try to avoid lengthy explanations in order to rely on the fact that the game explains itself. Of course, there is a list of the best scorers, because the competitive aspect is very important. And then you see the block, which is an important element in the game because it strengthens its social aspect. In the block, collaborators in the project give their ideas about general aspects of the game, but also on the whole problem of social tagging, and they of course answer to comments and questions by the users. As you can also see, there is yet another game, and we called it Carido. There are two explanations for adding further games, and I hope we will still add at least one further version. The one is tactical, the other tries to tackle the basic problem of tag quality. As we do not refer to a scientific, but to an unspecific internet community, the game has to be fun. By the way, the somewhat populist comments which we added below the pictures, which you can see on the right, on the introductory screen, are also intended to increase the fan factor and at the same time to pin the attention of people surfing by and usually going away very quickly, an extremely important point in the internet. A game in itself should be fun, but games tend to become annoying after a while, and in order not to lose our gamers, we try to switch them to another game. Carido is at the same time designed to enhance the quality of the tags, or better, to enhance their specificity. The player gets a whole range of images which tend to be visually similar, and she has to describe one of them in a way that this description cannot be confused with another one. Therefore, he cannot be generic, blue woman horse, but has to be more specific, dark blue queen gray horse. When the player is not precise enough, he gets edit request from his partner, the guesser, to specify his annotation. What I would love to do next, and now I lost the line, to set up an editorial game which I would call Tag a Tag. After 3 years by now, we have a lot of images tagged many, many times, and some of them have 30 to 40 matches. Now, what we register is that after having been presented dozens or even hundreds of times to the players, now and then errors creep in. Simple orthographic errors, but also interesting ones. For example, when a painting by Giulio Romano is matched with Raphael. This is, of course, interesting because not only at first sight a Giulio Romano can be very similar to a Raphael. In order to qualify such errors, I would propose to invite people to tag a tag. They will get the image and one of the matches, and then they have to decide, is it a good tag or is it a bad tag? In order to be somewhat more subtle, one could also offer them a scale from 1 to 10. A painting with just some blue spots would only get a 2 for the tag blue, and Eve Klein would receive a massive 10. But the basic function of this game would be to correct obvious errors. Do you recognize the consequences of such procedures? Can you imagine other applications where such approaches can be functional? I do. The tedious transcription of handwritten text could be delegated to the crowd, just to name an example, and you only have to find ways of giving this a certain fascination in order to seduce people to do something as tedious as this. You have to bring them to exploit themselves and to do that with fun. Because then it is fun. By the way, do you agree with me that this is not only a way to yield work to the crowds, but also to introduce society at large to what we are doing in our respective fields, and that this can be very helpful to justify our work, for example, for museums? I won't talk about museums, but they could use it. Mostly they don't, I don't know why, but we will attract them. If I had more time, I would now show you a game in action. You would see that we have set a time limit in order to enhance the competitive character of the game. You would also see the number of tags given by your partner, but of course not the word itself, because then you would just copy it. What is interesting for educational uses is the end of the game. After 5 minutes of strained tagging, all the tag pictures, no, I don't have that. All the tag pictures are presented again and now including their metadata, artist, title, dating. The idea behind is that people tend to remember better after having worked conceptually with a picture, as they have done while tagging it, than just having looked at it. Our art history students all have to have a certain knowledge of canonized artworks. This is admittedly not a very modern approach, but we still think it is important. Most of them scroll books in order to learn these metadata, but I'm sure it is a lot more intense when they do it in the context of such a game. Give them 5,000 reproductions of the essential of art history in such a game, whatever essential might is defined in an age in which the canon does not have good publicity, and then they will have memorized them. Once upon a time, I was engaged in developing e-learning units, and as many others, we made the effort to follow quite strictly the teaching models of the real world. Having made the experience with social tagging, I would tend to underline that such ways are didactically probably more effective, with the restriction, of course, that a game like Artigo is not intended for somewhat more complex discursive reasoning, but just for single or few word tagging. In the way described, we already have achieved two aims. We quickly have established an annotated picture database, and we also realized a didactic aim by making people acquainted with artworks. But there are other fascinating perspectives which we still have to realize and which I can, for the time being, only theoretically describe. Before I will do this, I will again discuss a fundamental skepticism as to the quality of the text. It is true that we avoided the grossest obstructions by organizing the tagging process as a game with two persons, the one unknown to the other in the internet, but this does not avoid that we mostly have very simple annotations which do not really match with professional expert descriptions. This is and it remains a problem, but there are, ways to improve the situation. Many of them, to be sure, I will just suggest two. You will remember that more than three quarters of the tags are not matched and remain hidden in the storage of the computer. A lot of them are misspellings, troll tags, and so on, but many of them are also extremely high quality, so very high indeed, that it takes time to find a second person who matches them. This second person is not found in actual live games, but in what we call simulated games. Very often, we do not have two real players at the same time, which is due to the fact that even 10,000 theoretical players are not sufficient to have two of them at exactly the same time online. But what looks like a problem could also be an advantage, because every time there are no two players present, we confront the one present with an old game which we simulate. The player really doesn't even notice it, because it looks like a real game. And I'm not sure if the one I showed you before, I would have shown you before if I could have shown you the game, I didn't change the text here, was not a simulated one. But if 2 years ago someone tagged with apokatastasis, that is the idea of a universal forgiving of the sins at the end of the days, mostly present in modern Protestant theological thinking, this tag certainly has to wait a while until it is matched. But one day it will be, and the tag waiting in the computer storage is reconciled itself by being matched. If this sounds too esoteric to you, I can offer another solution, and this solution is assured by a sophisticated gratification procedure. Normally you get a point for a match, but why not give 20 points for an expert tag? As soon as your players notice that they receive 20 points for an advanced concept, like, for example, apocatastasis, they will strive to find such advanced concepts. How can we automatically guarantee such a process? And most of you will know that already. There are several computer linguistic applications which define the frequency of a word. Blue and woman are very frequent words. Apocatastasis is, as you can imagine, very rare. We connect our game to this application, which is available online, and we tell the system to allocate a high score for rare words and a low one for frequent words. The assumption is that a frequent word is a generic one and that a rare word is a sophisticated one. This will not always be true, but generally it is. All I have been speaking about until now is on collecting many and good texts in order to improve the searchability of a picture database, which you can do at once. There is a search place which you can see above. You almost don't see it. It's above of the picture on the right. The real research aspect comes up when we begin to analyze the tags in them, tags, not the text, the tags in themselves and the way they were produced. The idea, tags report about two different entities, the individuality of the tagger and the characteristics of the items tagged. In both fields, it might be interesting to ask for the concepts chosen and also for the sequence of the tags. This last point is feasible because we give a timestamp to every chosen tag. It is trivial to suppose that different taggers assign different concepts. A child will find other tags than an adult. But there are more exciting and less obvious cases. What about women and men? Or what about Italians and Chinese taggers? It is known and adopted, for example, in eye tracking experiments, that persons from East Asia look at pictures in another way than Europeans. A European tends to begin with looking at the foreground, someone from China begins with the background. I wouldn't be surprised if such cultural differences are also expressed in the sequence of tags allocated. Certainly, it is a fascinating field of study, fascinating also because it opens up traditional art history to more general visual, psychological, perceptual studies. And for a more classical study of artistic styles, there could also be rewarding aims of research. Will an impressionist landscape be tagged differently from a classicist one, not just in the concepts chosen, but also in the sequence of their allocation, which would not be surprising because a landscape by Claude Lorrain is organized in a way which guides the eye through the painting differently from one by Monet. Such implicit knowledge could also be found in an example as the following. What will be the nature of a painting tagged with red, diagonal, and dynamic as the first three? Will it be a Rubens with a lot of red in it, a typically Baroque dynamism produced by diagonals in the painting? I do not think so, because taggers will probably first say man, Jesus, and Mary Magdalene, and maybe later also red, diagonal, and dynamic. No, it seems to be a lot more probable to me that it will be an abstract painting. Will a painting tagged 100 times blue be bluer than another one tagged only 5 times? An important problem for perceptual psychologists. How many similar and rewarding problems can be figured as soon as we have understood the nature of such a game? As I do not have enough time, I just mentioned that such games can, of course, also be considered in other fields, not just in art history. Imagine the use in linguistic field studies. To me, such games have the character of a real paradigmatic shift in a lot of empiric branches of the humanities. If we consider social tagging as a procedure in a more general way, something quite revolutionary about typical internet workflows might appear. Traditional knowledge building, especially in the humanities, relies on solitary work of a single thinker, the one who is working in the famous ivory tower. In the eyes of such a thinker, everything has to be deeply reflected about before being written down, the resulting text is the outcome of a spiny act, the dear child of a long time full of privations. To put this in the sober words of information science, the filtering process takes place very early in the brain of the thinker, before anything is put on the paper, which I do not ironize in any way, to be sure. For the sake of clarification, I just exaggerate the difference to typical internet workflows. Here, there is a tendency to prompt huge masses of information, which are filtered later in order to enhance their quality. Those masses are taken from the most heterogeneous sources. The whole accent of the procedure is laid on a sort of post-production, which assures that the gold is filtered from the mud. Publish first, filter later. That is the dictum by Clay Shirky that summarizes such a procedure, and which is extremely important as the definition of a typical internet workflow, which is not just a copy of the analogous workflow. It can be transferred to other fields outside social tagging, and I would like to finish my reflections by adding some thoughts about them. Most of you will have made the experience, at least the older ones, those who used to write on paper, that it is a lot less arduous to begin with writing down a text in the digital medium than it was before, when you sat in front of your sheet of paper which looked at you in all its splendid and reproachful emptiness. The ink on the paper had something definite. The letters on the computer screen can be obliterated, which gives us the good feeling that even the silliest ideas can be completely forgotten, erased. And if not completely forgotten, then at least they can be worked and reworked and totally transformed until the silliness has become a wisdom. Something similar can be observed in Wikipedia. Mostly the texts in Wikipedia are the result of a common effort. A current procedure here is that someone produces a short basic text, and as soon as this has been done, others go on with it, as if that had waited for someone making the first step. In my eyes, the relocation of the filtering process ahead in time, postponing it from the beginning in the sphere of pure thought to a later moment, is one of the most central and far-reaching aspects of intellectual production in the internet. And it may be a reason for the many enemies among our traditional humanists. If we generalize this insight, it can, for example, be used as a point of departure for defining the nature of the publication process in the internet age. As a fluid medium, the electronic text lacks the hieratic qualities the printed text used to have. This text, in its medial form, is a work in progress, never definite, always object of constant adaptation. In the printed form, the text is ponderous and not universally addressable. In the digital, it can be distributed extremely quickly and multifariously reconfigured. On the negative side, this is often criticized because it seduces to a very speedy text production. But there's also a positive side. More persons than ever before are able to write down their thoughts. And if this is also taken as a problem by highbrow intellectuals, it is because they feel scared in their leadership. Jürgen Habermas and his thoughts about the internet might be a case in point, but you can also take traditional journalism under the pressure of bloggers. In scholarship, in the stricter sense of the word, something similar can be foreseen, at least. In print culture, we are constrained to implement a prior filtering process in order to separate the wheat from the chaff, and if this was only for the lack of paper. This is usually organized in the form of a peer review. In the digital world, this is no more necessary, maybe even not recommendable, because we might find alternative procedures there. One of them could be an evaluating comment post festum, which is of some help for the reader drowning in the oceans of publications. If we add the precise addressability and the possibility to exactly assert the frequency with which a specific document has been retrieved, the problem of selection is halfway solved, and maybe better than today, where this problem has become urgent even under analogous conditions. Further electronically based methods for determining the pertinence of a text with regard to one specific way of posing a problem can be added. For example, I could imagine an automatic matching process with the qualification of an author in the internet. Even the tiny nibbles of information which in the eyes of the pessimists tend to dominate in modern publication culture in order to blow up one's record of publications then appear in another light. In the electronic medium, they can be easily, and again post festum, assembled to comprehensive aggregates of knowledge. It might sound scandalous in the eyes of conservatives, but even in digitally based scholarship, Clay Shirky might be right with the idea just quoted, publish first, filter later. The significance, and this is my last part, of what I have tried to shortly mention in this part of my talk cannot be overrated, because it will also entail deep cultural consequences. For the sake of clarification, I refer you to Chris Anderson's important study on the long tail, a popular paraphrase for the Italian Pareto principle. Few actors concentrate a huge mass on themselves. For the book market, this means that there is a small number of books with high sellings and a huge number of them with low ones. In the analogous economy, we have to follow the rule for concentrating on the blockbusters, because the long tail, the millions of books available but mostly unknown, is logistically unmanageable if your bookstore is smaller than a Walmart storehouse. And this is not just an economic constraint, but it also ensures mainstream culture, because what is extraordinary, strange, maybe deviant, is hidden in the long tail, where in traditional culture it tends to be forgotten or not even published, but maybe not in the digital culture. Referring to this to scholarship, all that remains necessarily unpublished in the prior reviewing procedure now has a chance. And this is not so far-fetched as in scientific print culture. There is heavy criticism of the fact that much that is innovative, and this is not so far-fetched as in scientific print culture, there is heavy criticism of the fact that much that is innovative falls through the cracks. This is certainly true for art history, where what is established normally beats what is original. This is very aggressive, I know. The problem of unmanageable masses would also be approached by such an innovative procedure. What is really nonsense or insignificant disappears in the depths of the computer storage, but it exists and can, when its time will eventually have come, re-emerge from there and leave behind the long tail. And now I would have a conclusion, but I have already needed 32 minutes and I will omit the conclusion. E grazie e alla prossima volta.
L'intero mondo è aperto davanti a noi e tutto è possibile, le applicazioni sono infinite, come giustamente ci rivela il professore. Io resto veramente affascinata da tutte queste prospettive. Questo sistema del senz'altro è utilissimo nel campo della didattica. Queste sono applicazioni che in quel campo sono veramente frutteranno molto, secondo me. Guardavo questo gioco, questo artigo, e mi chiedevo se non potevamo usare qualcosa del genere quando facciamo i test di ingresso alle nostre, i saperi minimi, li chiamiamo noi, nelle nostre facoltà. Si potrebbe organizzare qualcosa di simile. Forse verrebbero fuori atrocità meno esplicite di quelle che troviamo. Confesso che lo studente che confonde Giulio Romano con Raffaello, lo trovo veramente interessante, lo abbraccerei, perché mi sembra una cosa tutt'altro, è un giudizio critico importante, tutt'altro che così risibile, insomma. Mi sembra.